Hello, everyone, and welcome to The Green Flame, the Deep Green Resistance broadcast that brings you radical analysis, practical skills, and artistic expression from the revolutionary movement to defend the planet and rebuild just human communities. I am your host and comrade, Max Wilbert. Today's episode of the Green Flame podcast will focus on a group discussion of the documentary film I Am Not Your Negro about James Baldwin. We also would like to put out a request for help from our audience. When we're editing and putting together episodes of The Green Flame, one of our challenges is finding music to include with our shows. So if you are a musician or you're friends with any musicians who might be interested in submitting their work to be included in future episodes of The Green Flame, please get in contact with us. Thank you.
So this is our book club DGR discussion of the film I Am Not Your Negro. And to introduce this film to our listeners, I'm going to read the cover of the book that I bought, which is an accompaniment to the film and contains the script. To compose his stunning documentary film, I Am Not Your Negro, acclaimed filmmaker Raoul Peck mined James Baldwin's published and unpublished oeuvre, selecting passages from his books, essays, letters, notes, and interviews that are every bit as incisive and pertinent now as they have ever been. Weaving these texts together, Peck brilliantly imagines the book that Baldwin never wrote. In his final years, Baldwin had envisioned a book about his three assassinated friends, Medgar Evers, Malcolm X, and Martin Luther King Jr. His deeply personal notes from the project have never been published before. Peck's film uses them to jump through time, juxtaposing Baldwin's private words with his public statements in a blazing examination of the tragic history of race in America. So, with that introduction, I'd like to do a round and start with asking everyone in this discussion group, what was or is your experience of I Am Not Your Negro? And I'll start by saying, I've watched this film before. Every single time, it leaves me emotionally reeling. I can't watch this film without wanting to stop and pause after every two sentences or so, or pause on images, because they hit me so deeply and profoundly. So that's my beginning. Who'd like to go next?
So I'm from the UK and I've watched most of the clips, the interviews before. I've followed James Baldwin since I was a very young woman in my sort of late 20s, before he died. No, just after he died, I think. And it's only in the last 5 to 10 years that it's come to my attention that he wasn't just a niche and unusual author, writer, sort of in the shadows, that he was quite prominent. So for me, he's one of the few male heroes, one of the few male role models. So I'm kind of delighted that he's getting the attention that he deserves now. I connect with it incredibly deeply. There's part of my, to be a bit fluffy about it, part of my soul that resonates with who he is and how all those people, and I mean men, women and children, put their lives on the line for this. It's part of patriarchy that is deeply distressing, like the harm to women. So I see the parallel there.
Hi, I'm joining from Washington State in the USA. And I'll just say, yeah, I've seen this film before and read Baldwin's work before. And yeah, I'm always very struck. I'm so caught up and taken with him as a thinker. So he's so inspiring in terms of what he can put into language. And I'm so caught up in that, the beauty of that, and then also what he's revealing. You know, the reality that he is unveiling is so shocking and so abhorrent in certain ways that the contradiction is very sharp and interesting as I watched the film again.
Yeah, I've seen it before as well, a couple of times before, and it's still as sad as it was the first time I saw it. And I guess it is a film about, in some ways, loss. And he's talking about three friends that he lost, you know, so it is bound to be sad and full of grief, I guess. And obviously there's other other things that were lost as well, but that's one of the focuses of the film. So yeah, for me, the experience of the film is just really intense sadness.
The next question that I had for the group was, what are the most striking moments in the film for you?
So, like I said, I've watched all of these clips before, not in the documentary, and I just wasn't expecting that clip of Martin Luther King flinching after the gunshot. I've seen it so many times. We don't have that level of gun violence in the UK. Only when it's bird shooting season am I hearing that sound and am I seeing that. And I had such a visceral reaction to it. I just cried. It was just horrific. He was walking, shored up by those two men that were holding him up. And he knew there were guns. He knew he would die, could die. He knew that sound meant that could have been for him. And as soon as he was over the startle reflex, if you like, of his reaction, he carried on walking. It was so powerful. That will stay with me for several days.
I think the most striking moment for me, there were many, but when he was reflecting on the photo images of the 15-year-old girl walking into the previously segregated school, and the images of her face that were shown in the film and then his commentary on it. And I saw that the many of the images of faces were so moving and powerful, seeing the dignity and the grief and all of the most intense human feelings that come up in the face of racial hatred and violence. And so those images of her face, and then he said, one of us should have been there with her. You know, he saw, you know, you see behind all the white children and adults taunting her with their signs and their facial expressions. And he says, one of us should have been there with her. And I thought that was so powerful because it kind of like called me in, like, I'm in the us, right? Like, we're all in the us. One of us should have been there with her, you know? So it was this moment of accountability that I thought was powerful.
I think for me, every single clip of violence is striking enough to me. I really struggle to watch those things, let alone imagine what it must be like. I feel like I'm there when I see that kind of shocking scene on my TV screen. I have a bodily reaction. But I think one of the more subtle striking moments was when he was in, was it Cambridge? And he was standing up in the middle of a room of white people, and clearly rich, well-educated white people, if it was Cambridge, all with, you know, ridiculous outfits on. And he said his piece, and he's such an articulate man. And he sat down and they all gave him a standing ovation. And then you see his face, and his face is proper shock that everybody around him is standing up. And I just wonder, what was he thinking at that moment in time? I would have loved to have known what he was thinking. Was he feeling like he was in danger, that everybody was stood up, or was he shocked that he was accepted? I can't imagine what he was thinking. And that struck me because it was such a brave thing for him to do, but also such a curious moment.
I think that the very first time that I saw this film, what struck me the most were all of the clips of the moral monsters, you know, the two levels of experience, the Doris Day world, and then the world here. And that was amazing. This time around, one of the things that really struck me was the clip with John Wayne and Baldwin's eloquence in saying, we've made a legend out of a massacre, you know, that phrase. And there are so many in here that I could just grab onto and hold on to. And that's what I'm going to hold on to from this viewing.
No, I'll just echo what Cara was saying. I thought that was really powerful when all the people stood up around Baldwin. It was just such a deep sign of respect in terms of race and power and intelligence and how he articulated himself. Reverence, I would call it. So I just wanted to echo what Cara said. I did have a tear at that.
I find the whole scene, I think, which was split, the interview he did with the one of the, like, a chat show interviews he did, and it was split throughout a section of the film. I think where he was talking about how if we were fighting for freedom, but we were any other skin colour, the reaction to us would be very different from the establishment. And then immediately they brought out it was split, but you could tell then they brought out, after he'd spoken, they brought out a professor of philosophy, a white guy. And he was just coming out basically with what nowadays would be called all lives matter bullshit. Like, oh, you just need to, you know, you just need to integrate and get on with life and enjoy and connect with people. And just completely just spewing bullshit, basically. Just complete unawareness, I suppose. Yeah, and I just found that whole interview process, like he makes some amazing points. Then they immediately, some guy comes out to kind of object. Yeah, and you still see that kind of thing happening nowadays in many ways.
I really like the way he reacted to it as well, because he didn't say, no, that's not true. He just told his own truth afterwards, rather than trying to directly contradict it. He just, you know, said what he needed to say, which was amazing.
I agree. He starts his sentence, I'll say this. So he's kind of skirting a direct, you know, that politician speak, but he's just so eloquent. He's amazing. I'll say this to your question, Mr. White Man.
This may be a very, very obvious one, but is Baldwin's work relevant today?
We have this saying in the UK, does a bear shit in the woods? Do you say that? No?
Yeah, we do. Something similar.
Yeah.
Does a deer poop in the woods? A bear, yeah. Whatever.
Is the Pope Catholic? I think it's incredibly relevant. I think it was more relevant then. I don't think it's aged. I think his writings, his works, his life was is still as relevant.
I mean, you could see it's relevant, and you could see the filmmakers were pointing out that it's relevant today in the fact that it was showing a lot of more recent scenes, or from when the film was made, 2014 to 16, I suppose. Well, and the Rodney King beating and murder, and so yeah, you can see the progression basically of how maybe things have mildly changed, but at their root, what he's saying is still completely relevant. I also think just the way he says things as well is kind of needed in many ways as well. Just that the language he uses and the way, I find it quite poetic. And I think that's quite, I almost had to listen twice to certain things to take them in. Like I said, the second time I watched it, I took different things out of it. And I'm sure if I watched it again in another year, it might be the same. So it might, and it would still be relevant, I'm sure.
One of the things that struck me too is that call to take responsibility. You know, the past is present. It's never been dealt with here. And it feels, I guess, so visceral because it is America. This is America. This is the truth. And you have to take responsibility for that. And so that part of his work is absolutely timeless and will be until this nightmare is over.
Yeah, I'll just mention again for the podcast that, you know, before we started, I was talking about the recent riots at the Capitol in the United States. And I feel that this film tells us why that's happening and why things like that will continue to happen until he's really getting at it. He's really getting at the heart of the matter. And until we address the heart of the matter, which is much deeper than a lot of people think, this type of thing will continue in one form or another. And that's, I think, the power of Baldwin as a thinker is to have such a deep analysis. It's one thing that really sets him apart from a lot of even contemporary thinkers today who you would think would be more sophisticated from the benefit of learning from the past. But I don't know, I think he's incredibly thorough in understanding what is the void in the whites and in America in general. What is the void? What is the sickness? What is the dead inside state of living and being, and what are its causes, you know? And he doesn't actually spell them out exactly. He knows it's enough to ask, and we can all provide the answer because we live with it, right? Well, those of us who are here, and there are parallels in other countries, but not the same situation, obviously.
Yeah, I think, of course, it's still relevant. And I think he said that you can't change anything unless you face it. And most people haven't faced it, and certainly we haven't faced it as a culture, either in America or in the UK. You know, we haven't faced our past as a culture, our empire, or our involvement in the slave trade, because we were involved in it. And you know, he's right. He said actually that you might not be able to change it even if you do face it, but you definitely can't change it if you don't face it.
The exact quote, because I wrote it down, is, "Not everything that is faced can be changed, but nothing can be changed unless it is faced."
Yeah.
So yeah, I thought that was a great piece of, you know, intelligence.
I think that this is brilliant because it's leading into a question that I have about how the history of the civil rights movement may pertain to where you are living on Earth. We've got people from the UK here. Does the history of the civil rights movement have relevance to the rest of the world?
Yeah, I think it does, because I think every struggle against oppression, every struggle for freedom helps the next one and inspires the next one. So in that way, yeah, it can help. And I mean, it's funny, I was thinking about school and what we learn in history, and we learn Martin Luther King, but we didn't learn about Baldwin and we didn't learn about Malcolm X. And I think that tells its own story as well, what we weren't taught. But I think the answer is definitely yes, that it is relevant, and we should learn about as many different struggles for freedom as we can.
For me, funnily enough, we were speaking to an American lady about this just after we watched it. And she was talking about how she grew up in, you know, in that America. And for me, it seems there's a lot of it I can't relate to, because I grew up in East and North London. There was a very diverse place and a very integrated place. So I've never known anything else. And I actually find it odd when I'm in a group of just white people and I notice the absence. So I can see that contrast in my experience there. But the racism is the same. You know, just because there's no segregation doesn't mean that the racism isn't there.
I wanted to add something about the experience for me anyway. Is my mother tells me that when Martin Luther King was assassinated, I just cried and cried and cried and cried and cried. And that's before I, you know, was politically conscious really at all. Maybe that's what I said earlier, I believe, was about being in America. This is our history. This is, you know, this is it. And I can't remember a time. There has never been a time in America when this isn't the long trajectory and the long story of how it goes. I mean, you could take this film and the clips from today and what's happened since this film of May would be eerily similar to the clips that they use in the film about this history of the civil rights movement and what happens before and before and before. It's always been there. Anyone else who'd like to respond to that question about the civil rights movement being relevant where you are? Thanks, Amy.
Yeah, last year in the town where I live, there were a group of young Black people who wanted to organize a Black Lives Matter protest. And they were really energetic and hesitate to say one of the Black men were quite dominant, but they were passionate about getting something off the ground, but they hadn't done any organizing before and they hadn't got a police liaison, and it was all starting to feel really scary and overwhelming. So me and a colleague friend of mine stepped in and as white people, but we supported them to think about how they could organize effectively. And we expect, our town is notoriously rubbish at organizing, it's just really difficult. We would have been happy with 100 people. We'd have been ecstatic with 200 or 300 people. We were completely blown out of the water. We had over 1,000 people turn up, and the police were obedient and they supported us. They supported it to happen. And the speeches from the women and the children and the Black men on that day were incredible, incredibly powerful. So yes, we might have a different form of racism. We might not have had the sort of segregation in America, but it's very, very similar over here. You know, it's brutal. We have institutional racism, personal, cultural, political discrimination. Yeah, definitely. It's the same thing. It's the same thing, just a slightly different flavor.
I'll just say I already spoke to the, you know, the recent riots here in the States, but on the Green Flame episode on revolutionary organizing with Ajama Umi, that's a pretty recent one. He speaks to this, you know, he speaks about this being a global issue, the oppression of particularly of African origin peoples, but also indigenous peoples and all over the world. And so I think it is relevant literally everywhere.
It's the same pattern, isn't it? It's relevant everywhere because it's the same pattern. And when we compartmentalize women or race or Jewish people or class, or, you know, when we compartmentalize, what we do is focus on a single issue thing, and the destruction of our planet and that the harms that slavery and race issues and, you know, violence towards women, all of those issues together highlight the pattern, that's the destructive pattern. I mean, I'm not trying to say for a second that one thing's more harmful than the other. I know that two or three women every week die in the UK alone from male violence. And if you look at a different country like Mexican capital, for example, people in Mexico, women in Mexico are dying, and there's no police investigation. They don't bother reporting it in some cases. So I think we have to look at the patterns, not just the single issue thing. Yeah.
And I think to understand that patriarchal violence is going on inside, you know, Bell Hooks talks about this, and she says the first victim of patriarchal violence is the man himself. He must kill off part of his own humanity before he's able to perpetrate violence on another and dehumanize another. And I believe that to be true. I believe I've seen that 100,000 times. And so when Baldwin is pointing to the emotional illness, he's right on target, right? He's right on target with what is missing, what has been lost, and what has shown up as almost like a defense mechanism, coping mechanism, and then intersected with a bunch of violent ideology that really comes from the same source. But it's like, how does this happen to everyday people all the time? We're not just talking about a few monsters at the top. How is this happening in everyday lives of young people growing up, you know? And that, I think that it has to have, yeah, it's learned, it happens through a system, and then it becomes sort of self-perpetuating. If you kill off the parts of a person that think it's okay to be vulnerable and to ask for help and to want deep connection, you know, you've effectively killed that person, and they will have nothing left to do but harm other people.
So almost at the end of the film, I'll just read this out. History is not the past. It is the present. We carry our history with us. We are our history. If we pretend otherwise, we literally are criminals. I attest to this. The world is not white. It never was white, cannot be white. White is a metaphor for power. And that is simply a way of describing Chase Manhattan Bank. Would you like to speak to that, anyone?
Yeah, my memory is terrible, and I don't remember specifics of anything I read or watch, but I did remember that very powerful ending quote. And it's so true. And we, as white people and as a class of people, we really do seem to think that we are the be-all and end-all and that we're the most important. And actually, it's so true, you know, the proportion that we are is nothing really compared to all other races in the world. And we just forget about the rest of the world, and we forget about the races that are even, you know, living locally to us. So yeah, I think it's spot on really. It's really, really powerful.
I'd like to say one thing about this that I found consistently with a Baldwin's work is I'll be going along and I'll be getting it, and then I'll get hit with something that's so deep I have to sit with it for a long time and I'm going to be worrying it out. And the one in here that really gets me is, if we pretend otherwise, we literally are criminals. That has my head spinning. To deny your past, to deny how you are that past is a criminal act. And especially as a white person, the way that are, you know, being white and being so oblivious to the power that you wield, that white is a metaphor for power. It's a criminal act not to be owning that history. And I love that. And I'm still digging into it on a personal level as well as a societal level to understand that completely.
So there's two things. I really like what Audre Lorde said, although I know she was speaking from a feminist perspective. She was a black lesbian feminist. So when she wrote her essay, "Your Silence Will Not Protect You," I think that that's relevant on so many levels in this context. And one of my earliest, not earliest, but when I was becoming politically aware, we have a black poet in the UK called Benjamin Zephaniah. And he wrote a poem, it's very brief. If I can read it now, it might take me 1 minute. So this is White Comedy by Benjamin Zephaniah. "I was white mailed by a white witch, with white magic and white lies, branded by a white sheep, enslaved as a white smith, near a white spot where I suffered white water fever. Whitelisted as a white leg, I was in a white book as a master of white art. It was like white death. People call me White Jack. Some hailed me with white wog. So I joined a white witch, trained as a white guard, lift off the white economy, caught and beaten by the white shirts. I was condemned to a white mass. Don't worry, I'll be right into the black house." So he basically just took everything black and switched it on its head. And when I first heard that poem, I thought really deeply about the impact of racism in our country. So, yeah.
Wow, thank you.
I think I'm truly facing the past is, well, it's certainly difficult for me as a white British man, because it's more than disturbing, it's more than cruel, it's, you know, more than all the horrors of the world have been done by people who are my countrymen, however you want to call it. And so facing that is something that is difficult, but it's absolutely necessary. And if, you know, he's right, if we don't do it, it's criminal, because as much as what he said is still relevant, the past, our past is still relevant to what's happening now. And, you know, we can say we've made some progress, but I think it's almost imperceptible, really. The progress we've made is not, it's kind of, it's on the surface of progress. It's all on the surface. It's not real progress. And that's because we still haven't fully faced that history and fully, like Amy pointed out, fully kind of understood the patterns as a culture. You know, we haven't done it, because if we'd done it, then, you know, we wouldn't need DGR, because people would move on from civilization to something else, you know? So yeah, if we don't truly face that and truly analyze it and truly learn from it, then it is criminal.
Yeah, I will try and add some thoughts that just came up and then we're speaking. Yeah, we're talking about past and history. I think it's interesting that different people might have different perceptions of what that means. And it's important to, like, at first I was thinking, well, I need to acknowledge my own past and history, you know, things that maybe have been built into me as an individual, because I would have been bred in many ways to be racist and sexist. It just was part of the culture that I grew up in, like, not questioned. And also, obviously, there's the family history and then there's the cultural history. But then we also need to take that very important step of looking at the humanities history to get into a critique of where this is all coming from, and maybe some acknowledgement that this is like a speck of shit on our history, this little last 10,000 years, etc., of civilization, and have a proper look at what we actually are as a species and who we are, to get some context, real context. And I think often, too often, maybe some people will focus on personal history, some people will focus on the history of civilization without questioning all of our millions of years of being, of living in very similar forms before that, before civilization existed. But for me, without perspective on the whole thing, you can't really move forward or learn from any of it. You're just going to carry on going around in circles as we've been doing. And yeah, when, as Ben's pointing out about the progress thing, it's not, as long as you're looking linear in that term of looking at, let's make progress from A to B over, you know, we're progressing from from the 18th to the 19th century and the 20th century, and we're all constantly getting freer, et cetera, et cetera, or just all the general progress spiel that we hear. Yeah, that's not really, again, it's surface stuff. It's not really, like Ben said, it's surface stuff. It's not really getting to the core of the issue.
It is hidden, isn't it? It's like there's a big collusion around what it is. And at the moment, me and some friends are reading a book by Heidegottener Abendroth called Matriarchal Societies, which is a study on indigenous cultures across the globe. And her whole introduction lists 200 years of patriarchal expertise on all sorts of things, on history, on culture, on, what's that word, the study of human beings, anthropology. And she explains the flaws in it in a way that illuminate the lies that have been cast, created and colluded with. In, she does that in such a way that is all, she does it in an academic way, in a very, very clear methodological way, but she does it in a way that makes you remember that we've been lied to our whole lives. And, you know, even 40 years ago when they were saying in the film that we watched, maybe one day if you're really good enough, you'll have a black president. And then, yeah, you've got your Disney ending. Barack Obama was your Disney ending, and weren't you happy? Look, we gave you the Disney ending. So I think there are, and that simile goes back to the Doris Day, you know, simile with the blues singer. It's just looking at the world through really distorted eyes. Yeah.
Thanks, Amy. It was really interesting as well when he said that if you're really good in 40 years, you'll get your black president. And the year that he said that, it must have been pretty close to 40 years when Barack actually was made president.
So I really think this has been a great discussion and has gone in a lot of different directions. I'd like to add that when I watched the presentation with Vanderbilt, with the filmmaker, he did say that the lived experience of women a couple of times and the way that women have to think about where they're going, what they're wearing, all of the things that we do is similar or could be similar to what you feel as a black person, because you're encountering that huge level of violence. And that, I thought that was really interesting. And also part of, you know, a part of a discussion about the process of making the film itself, he brought that up a couple of times, which was really interesting to me. So, you know, when you brought up Haida, Amy, and the way that she cuts to the quick and cuts through the crap, I mean, I think Baldwin does the same way, same kind of thing. We need those people to just like tear it all off. But then Baldwin also, for me, has this thing about you have to accept responsibility. We're never going to move past that. We brought this up a couple of times in the conversation, and be mature about it. You know, reach a level of maturity. All of this willful ignorance and all of this immaturity was called out in the film as well. So that's all I've got to say. And it's been really great being with you all. Yeah.
Just wanted to say one more thing. I feel like it's really important.
Good.
I think something we have to highlight here as well, because I suppose some people will be listening to this rather than watching it, is that we are a bunch of white people. And it would have been really nice to hear from a diverse audience as to what they thought as well. And of course, our opinions and our interpretations are going to be so different than somebody who has experienced, you know, racial prejudice. And I just think it's really worth noting that, because we can never fully understand.
Sometimes up and sometimes down. dying for the gallows. I look over Jordan, and what did I see? Coming for the gallows.
This is Max Wilbert, one of the hosts of the Green Flame podcast. I want to thank you for listening to our show and let you know a few ways that you can support the Green Flame. First, you can subscribe to our platform using the podcasting system of your choice. We're listed on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, iHeartRadio, Pocket Cast, and all the rest. We're even on YouTube. Leaving us a positive review or rating on these platforms helps us reach a larger audience. You can also share these shows with your friends. If you're interested in donating to support the production of The Green Flame, please visit deepgreenresistance.org. And finally, the goal of this show is to activate people. So if you really want to support this show, start organizing in your own community. Thank you again for listening.